Is there a first movie that you remember seeing, or the first movie that had an impact on you?
I don't remember the first movie I ever saw.
I remember my parents took me to see Close Encounters of the Third Kind. I don't remember actually going there, so that's a lie. I was an infant.
The first movie I saw is going to really make me sound weird, which was Nanook of the North.
The Muppet movie, and when they were doing the moving right along sequence, I was like, that's a puppet bear driving a car.
Right, how did
Who's
they do that?
Who's driving the car?
I still don't understand.
Gone with the Wind was the first movie that I remember being sort of affected by in an almost physical way.
I saw Five Easy Pieces at 19, and I loved it so much that it was like it was the first movie I ever saw.
Yeah, the one that just twisted my head around was Blow Up. And the way Antonioni told a story.
John Waters movies I saw at a really young age. Serial Mom in particular was like kind of life altering for me.
I was living in a hippie commune and we were all super duper poor, like insanely poor. Like you would only have a pair of shoes in the winter and then you'd grow out of them by summer and be scampering around with no shoes. And but we saw those movies. Fiddler on the Roof, we built a whole village, all of us hippie kids, in this little kind of arroyo. And we would play that every day. We would play Anatevka.
If I were a rich man, yabba-dibba-dibba-dibba-dibba-dibba-dibba-dum.
In my little grandpa overalls that I had then.
So
grandpa
did you get to be Tevye?
Hmm?
Did you get to be Tevye? Or
no,
you?
I was just like a little kid in their little hovel, like washing things in a washing bowl.
I saw Harold and Maude when I was 12 years old. I don't know why my parents let me see it. I was on a vacation with my family in New Hampshire, and we were in some like summer resort, and my parents were having a great time. And my sister and I were shunted over to some like weird cottage where they showed movies to the kids. And they showed Harold and Maude for some reason, and my parents were like, "You should see this movie. It's awesome," and it blew my mind.
Oh, Harold, there's one. Go and love some more.
My mom took me and a couple other kids, and we were kids to see Brian De Palma's Dressed to Kill, you know, like 10. And the first scene is Angie Dickinson, I think, like masturbating in the shower. My mom, I think it was like my birthday and there were like four kids and she just somehow didn't know what it would. I remember her sitting there.
Did she get you out of the cinema?
No, we stayed, we watched it. But we're sitting here like at 11 or whatever, is this woman's masturbating in the shower. My mom just going, oh my God.
The first movie I really remember in the theater was The Little Mermaid. I don't know if it reflects me in any way as an adult and my taste as an adult, but I was like obsessed with mermaids as a kid. I like had my birthday party at The Little Mermaid when I was a kid, and that was a big deal for me. And then I watched Splash over a million times.
Willow was like, it's my first real movie going experience that I remember, and there was popcorn and we were all sitting there, and then it just scared the shit out of me. Like, I felt strangely attracted to Val Kilmer, which is weird because I was 7, but I was like, ooh, he's kind of sexy. Like, feelings I did not understand.
Annie.
It's the hard knock life for us. It's the hard knock life for us.
I've watched Annie for some reason, I think maybe over 100 times as a kid. I really did.
When I'm stuck with a day that's gray and lonely,
I would just play the movie over and over again.
I just stick out my chin and grin and say,
just seeing Annie being the underdog and really struggling and also getting what everybody wanted, which is a loving family and
tomorrow, tomorrow, I love ya. Tomorrow, you're only a day away.
What kid didn't fantasize about being an orphan?
The first one is Jungle Book. And I think I cry for almost 10 nights in a row. I want to be erased by a bear and a panther, not by my mom and my dad. It was too cool to be erased by a bear.
Look for the bare necessities, the simple bare necessities. Forget about your worries and your strife.
And I want to live in the jungle. I was not very happy where I was living at the time, and so yeah, this I remember clearly. Yeah,
I must have been about 5 or 6, and I remember it like it was yesterday. And it was Snow White and the Seven Dwarfs, and it was the witch. The witch fucked me up. She was very scary.
A perfect disguise.
So I'm not gonna say Bombi because, but it was true.
Bambi. Bambi's mommy dying. No question, that's the one. Broke my heart. And I remember asking my mother afterwards, years afterwards, say, why did they let children go through that kind of grief? And she said, because it's part of life. They must know. And I thought it was a very interesting thing in terms of the notion of embracing death as a part of life. You know, oddly enough, when she died in the hospice and was given a beautiful death that completely framed her life afterwards. It's a very interesting thing. So it was, I had good taste pretty early on.
I have a very clear first movie memory, which is when I was a child back in 1843. There was a movie theater in New York that showed movies and you could eat food in the movie. Like it was like a rear projection screen. It was in the East 50s and you could eat food, like you could order a hamburger or whatever. And my dad was like, there's a movie I want you to see. I was a little kid. I'd probably seen a movie or two, but I don't really remember. But he was like, let's you and me go to this movie. We're going to get a hamburger. And I remember like thinking about a cheeseburger and being excited about it. And I so clearly remember sitting there, and the movie was King Kong. I saw it in this theater with my dad eating a cheeseburger, and it is indelible. It's still one of my favorite movies.
It wasn't the airplanes. It was beauty killed the beast.
It's a memory of my dad too, and of cheeseburger.
The film that prompted me to get off my ass and actually go make a film was Thin Blue Line. I mean, I remember sitting in a theater at the Lincoln Plaza Cinemas.
Watching Errol Morris's Thin Blue Line. I mean, now so many people copy. I mean, it's been repeated and ripped off and copied. But if you could put yourself back in what it was like to be sitting in a theater then.
Saw the Miramax logo come up, and it felt like this very theatrical experience. I was just mesmerized by the Thin Blue Line.
It's like feeling like you have been given license by a filmmaker who's gone before you and has sort of broken down some walls to then take it in another direction in your own work.
Literally, I walked out of that theater and I said, I've got to start my film career.
2001. I think the thing about Kubrick's work that really spoke to me was the epic quality. And I think it, in a weird sort of way, I know this is going to seem like a weird analogy, I think that's why some of the films I've done, I've attempted, like Hoop Dreams, to kind of achieve a kind of mini epic, intimate epic kind of quality to them, because there was something just sort of grand about trying to say something big.
Star Wars.
And that, for me, was the film that was ground zero for my love of the medium, as it were.
I saw a double bill of Star Wars and The Empire Strikes Back. I know that's not like a big, I mean, like everybody of my age.
Star Wars or Empire Strikes Back, I'm not sure if I saw them out of order.
I didn't see it when it came out in May. I went back to school in September and everyone had seen it.
I absolutely adored Star Wars. I was like, couldn't believe it. And then I was completely terrified by Empire Strikes Back. I don't know, it was a double bill because there was a movie theater like a block from my house. And I couldn't make it past the AT-AT attack. I went from like bliss to terror and I had to leave, we had to leave.
I remember having the book of Return of the Jedi with all the pictures and the entire story, and there's big reveals in that movie. I mean, it just didn't matter.
These aren't the droids you're looking for.
I remember having a really violent, like upset reaction as a little kid screaming, he's coming back, right? I mean, he didn't die, right? And he didn't, you know, and I was really angry and upset. It's like, you should be rooting for the good guys. See, what are you doing? Rooting for the bad? But, you know, I mean, Vader, I don't know. Maybe that's the character actor in me, you know. Vader was cooler than anybody. He was the coolest part about Star Wars.
You are beaten. It is useless to resist.
What inspired me in so many areas of my life in terms of not just filmmaking, but music and my imagination as a writer. And it was a real, it was a key text for me.
And all the kids were lying on couches and stuff and sitting around, about 100 kids, right? And dogs running around and the TV on, little black and white crappy TV. And a movie comes on called Picnic at Hanging Rock.
When I was in elementary school, I watched the Angry George Glujo, the Ways of Fear in television. I overwhelmed and it's really 너무 긴장해서 봐서 온몸이 땀에 젖으면서 봤다고.
Yeah, he was really tense the whole way through watching that film. He was like sweating as he saw the film.
Apocalypse Now is the one that made me want to be a filmmaker. Strangely, because the experience of it looks horrific, but it also looked like an adventure, you know? The idea of going into the jungle with a bunch of people and building this gigantic, magnificent work of art looked like so much fun.
Someday this war's gonna end.
Dumb and Dumber.
Really?
Hey, this helps. That works good.
First memory of a movie. I'll pick a funny one as opposed to something serious or particularly honest.
Was Dumb and Dumber not a good answer?
No, Dumb and Dumber is a good answer.
My uncle, Gene Siskel, who is a film critic, he took me to a screening of a Woody Allen film when I was quite young. And probably way too young to be seeing it. I saw Bananas in the theater. Let's just say the suck out the poison scene. Google the suck out the poison scene and imagine an 8-year-old seeing that with his very cool uncle for the first time. That is a great movie memory for me.
In the event of snake bite, you make an incision and you suck out the poison. Remember, you suck out the poison.
Snake bite! I got bitten by a snake! I got bitten by a snake! Help! Snake bite!
Sneaking into Animal House was big. SNL stuff. I even like Neighbors, the old one with Belushi and Aykroyd.
I'd say it's like a tie of like, it was Sleeper. Had an impact on me.
I will use my title to bring peace to all nations of the world, be it black, be they white, be it colored, be it whatever.
Kentucky Fried Movie both had a huge impact on me. And I found them both hysterical. and Kentucky Fried Movie also had a lot of nudity, which I'm sure I enjoyed at that age.
Catholic
Schoolgirls in Trouble. But there was a final like newscaster sketch that blew my mind. I'm sure you remember it.
My dad brought me into Manhattan to see The Gods Must Be Crazy. Mm-hmm. And I didn't know what, you know, what was an art house movie as a kid, or, you know, back in the day when, you know, movies like that, they were only coming to Manhattan. And I never laughed so hard in my whole life. I had never seen something that funny in my whole life.
I collect manure. Get away from!
No! Leave me alone!
Is this a job? Because if this is a job, it's what I want to do.
The first movie that I loved with my entire being and was obsessed with and wanted to watch every day was Wild at Heart. That was the first movie when I was like a young teenager, and I saw that movie. I just was like, you can feel like this. The movies are made that encompass all of these different things. This craziness and passion and just like, it's funny and it's tragic and it's beautiful and it's ugly. That's the first movie that I was in love with.
I'll mention a scene in a movie. I could BS you, you know.
Please BS me.
but I'll be honest. It was a film called Buttons and Bows with Bob Hope and Jane Russell.
Let's vamoose where gals keep using those silks and satins and linen that shows, and you're all mine in buttons and bows.
And as I recall, maybe I'm wrong, I'd have to see the scene again. The Jane Russell and Bob Hope are laying down by this fallen tree, and the Indians on the horses are jumping over the fallen tree, and I'm looking at her and I'm saying, woman. I mean, as a kid, I'm saying, woman.
You looking for someone?
Like, I remember the first time I watched Grease. It was huge, because I didn't watch TV much as a kid, and I remember suddenly I was at some family's house, and suddenly they put on the TV and boom, the colors and those songs, and that was just like, okay, I'm loving this.
I remember seeing a film with Danny Kaye in it, and being very young, and my brother, I'm very close with my brother, and we saw the film together, and he was playing, I think he was playing, I don't even know what the name of it was, he was playing a twin, and at one point his twin either was drowned or fell into the river, and he's wandering along the riverbank, and he's shouting for his twin, whose name was Buster. And he's shouting, Buster, 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 right? And my brother started to cry because he said, he wants his custard and they won't give it to him. And then I started to cry because that seemed so unfair and we had to be taken out.
Hooray
for Hollywood.
Hooray for Hollywood. Thank you so much.